Seamless Web, which is now public as Grubhub, Take Care Health Systems, and Nutrisystem. Among the Fortune 500 companies that have acquired his portfolio are Aramark, Intel, IBM, Walgreens, and Yahoo. He is currently on the boards of the Jewish Federation of Greater Philadelphia, Einstein Healthcare Network, and formerly the Kimmel Center for the Performing Arts and Jewish Federations of North America. Wayne is a graduate of the University of Maryland at College Park and the Delaware Law School. He is passionate about his family, sports, and making the world a better place. Please help me welcome Wayne.
Thank you, Michael, and thanks to all of you for coming out and braving the weather tonight. But it's so much nicer here than it is back north. I live in Philadelphia now, and it's still not cold, right? So at least it's raining and it's not cold. That's the good thing. It's really a pleasure to be here tonight, and I'm excited to spend time with all of you. I'll tell you, talk about a couple things, and then hopefully be able to answer your questions and just get to know each other. So before we get started, I'm going to play a quick video that talks to give you a little bit of a background as to who I am.
It was the mid-90s, and I started to go to these tech events, and I started seeing people crowding around certain individuals, and I wanted to know who they were. And they were venture capitalists. They were the venture capitalists that were investing in the entrepreneurs that were changing the world. I wanted to be one of those guys. I don't just write checks to entrepreneurs. When I invest in an entrepreneur and their company, we become partners. We work together. My network, my contacts, all my relationships, when I invest in an entrepreneur, they become theirs. Because when I was 29, and when I started in the venture capital business, I was that entrepreneur. I was that entrepreneur who was trying to start a venture capital business. And every single day, I think about myself as an entrepreneur. I never, ever am tired when I wake up in the morning. I jump right out of bed. I love what I do. I love it because every single day I get an opportunity to work with people who are truly changing the world, and that's what I'm all about. The bottom line is, if you're an entrepreneur and people are calling you and your idea crazy, you're probably moving in the right direction.
So, we're going to talk tonight about my three favorite things to talk about. Entrepreneurship, networking, and giving back. And we're going to talk about all these things and how, if you really want to be, I believe, a really successful business person, as well as just being successful in life, what that means if you're an entrepreneur, what it means to be an entrepreneur, what it means, and why I believe networking is so important, and building your contacts and creating relationships with people. And then why it's so important to help others and try to make this world a better place for everybody. So, this is me. I grew up in Wilmington, Delaware. And I don't think anyone else, anyone here from Delaware? I forgot. Every time I say it, I'm like, oh my God. It's Will, right?
Yes.
So Will and I know Will's dad. Thanks for your dad for emailing the fact that for you to come. But I grew up in Delaware, and I typically never, ever meet anybody from Delaware, so it's great to have that happen.
That state.
Exactly. I mean, I've been going around the country, you know, with my book, and thank you for all of you for getting a copy of it, and I'm happy to sign it for everybody. And I've been going around all over the country, and most of the time I never get a chance to talk to anyone who's from Delaware. And it's interesting, and it's going to tie into some of the things we're going to talk about. One of my last talks, a couple weeks ago, was as part of the Aspen Institute. Anyone ever heard of the Aspen Institute? The Aspen Institute is this think tank, they don't call themselves a think tank, a place where they kind of discuss a lot of ideas, and a lot of the top thinkers of the world go to these events. And I got an opportunity to speak at one of their events recently. And the whole event was sponsored by the Bezos Foundation, the Bezos Family Foundation. That's Jeff Bezos, the guy, the Amazon guy. And it was interesting. I put this slide up, and this guy comes over to me afterwards and says, I want to introduce myself. My name's Mike Bezos. And he's like, my son is Jeff. And he said, and I went to high school in Delaware. And so without sort of talking about these types of things and figuring out how you have connections with people, I wouldn't have gotten an opportunity to meet Mr. Bezos. And it's incredible what they do as a family and their foundation, et cetera. We'll talk about that later. But it's just something that we'll talk about how it's all about relationships. So as Michael said, I kind of describe myself as an entrepreneur first, venture capitalist, aspiring philanthropist, now author, sports fan, and someone who really likes to, loves being a venture capitalist, loves being in the business of trying to work with people, to find the right kinds of people. So at 76 Capital, what we do is we invest in smart and nice people, smart and nice entrepreneurs who are trying to change the world, trying to create these game-changing businesses. And yes, I did say nice. And you probably won't hear that from a lot of financial and business people. But what I do, what I think is so important, is to make sure that you work with the right kinds of people, especially the kind of business that I'm in, the venture capital business. When we invest in companies, we invest in startups. And these companies take a long time to be successful, which means I have to spend a lot of time with people. And I want to make sure that the people I spend time with, that I'm trying to build businesses with, are the right kinds of people. And I don't want to work with people that aren't nice. And so fortunately, over the years, I've had an opportunity to work with some really great entrepreneurs who are great people, but also built some amazing companies. And some of those companies are listed up here in the Durham area, an investor in Reverb Nation, I don't know if you've heard of that company, they're right down the road, as well as AdWorks. They're both two companies that are here. If you're in the music industry or interested in the music industry, you want to create you have your own band or you're an artist, Reverb Nation, we have over 2 million artists that use our tools to help promote themselves, whether it's Imagine Dragons or Alabama Shakes or Casey Musgraves, they all started using with us, using our tools to be who they are today. We were the investors if you walk into a Walgreens, you want to get checked out inside of a Walgreens, those clinics where there's a nurse practitioner inside. We started that company and sold that to Walgreens. And it was us, and then if you see the ones you see in CVS, the Minute Clinics, we were competitors. They sold to CVS and we sold to Walgreens. And we got involved in these companies very, very early. The same thing with crowdfunding, with Indiegogo. It was when they first were starting. When Slava Rubin, who is a guy, he's actually came to America and grew up in Philadelphia, went to Penn, and he was one of the guys who started Indiegogo. And people didn't even know what crowdfunding was at the time. And we were one of the original investors in this. If you're involved if you're interested in healthcare, Startup Health is something that I highly recommend you taking a look at. But we've fortunately been involved in lots of really interesting companies over the years. So we're going to talk about entrepreneurship today. And I want to play you a quick video that I really believe epitomizes and really is what entrepreneurship is all about to me. I'll show you. I'm going to play this video for you.
Here's to the crazy ones. The misfits. The rebels. The troublemakers. The round pegs and the square holes. The ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
So this was a commercial and a campaign that Steve Jobs, when he came back as the CEO of Apple for the second time. This was the commercial that they played. This was their campaign all about thinking differently and finding people. I don't know how many of you have ever seen this before, but it's, to me, I mean, this video, I get to see it a lot, and it gives me the chills every single time. Because when I hear, when you look at these words, while some of them see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. And so I tell people, I tell entrepreneurs, I tell young people all the time, if you have a crazy idea, and your aunt, your uncle, your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, whatever, think it's crazy, and it's way out there, and they don't understand what you're talking about, you're moving in the right direction. You're moving in the right direction, because if you're doing something truly innovative, if you want to do something that no one else understands, then it better be something that's out there, right? It better be something that no one can see, that maybe five years from now they'll understand it. And that's what a true entrepreneur is. That's where, you know, fortunately, with some of the companies we talked about earlier that I've been involved with, where people said, you're going to order food online? Why would you ever order food online? It doesn't make any sense. You just pick up your phone, you call in your order, or you fax it in. Yeah, there's a fax machine. Just put it on the fax machine. Send it in your, you know, does anyone even have a fax machine anymore? You don't even know what a fax machine is, right? I mean, like, this was how people would order their food, but why would you do this stuff online? Why would you do this thing called crowdfunding? Why would you do, the list goes on of all the things. Why would we be using all the things that we have today, whether it's the different social networks, et cetera? I mean, this stuff is unbelievable, what's happening. That, to me, that's what the definition of an entrepreneur is. Now, I think what's amazing is that what happens on Shark Tank. I don't know how many of you watch this show, but as Michael said, you've been very fortunate to have had the opportunity to co-invest with Mark in a couple different companies, including Startup Health. And, you know, I love what this is all about. Why do I love this show so much? I love it because what it's doing is it's actually like democratizing entrepreneurship. It's democratizing this idea of being able to go out there and go create businesses and create opportunities. It's allowing anyone and everyone to know what a valuation is, to anyone and everyone understand how to pitch their business, how to say, I want to sell this amount of my business. I mean, like, those types of things were, when I was sitting in your seats, when I was in college, in the late 80s and early 90s, no one talked about business. No one talked about creating things and creating their own companies. The people that went to business school were going into like high finance or, I don't know, they were like accountants or something. It wasn't this idea they want to go create things. It wasn't the idea of like, you know, what's possible, what's available today. And what these guys are doing is opening up not only to just the most elite people and the most elite students like you guys, but to everybody. And so everyone in the world now knows understands what's happening. And so I believe in the next 5 to 10 to 15 years, we're going to see innovations that are going to blow people's minds, way better than anything that's out there today. So how do you actually go about becoming a successful entrepreneur or being successful in whatever you want to do? Well, I think one of the keys to it is to be a great networker. And now, I'm sure that you hear this in other situations, because now it's kind of like the hot thing, go network and meet people. But a lot of people don't really talk about how to actually do it, and where to do it, and what do you wear, and what do you say, and what do you carry with you, right? It's just like, you just say, people say, go network, but that's a hard thing to do. What's your goal? What are your goals in networking, right? The goals of networking are for you to go out and make as many contacts as possible and take those contacts and create relationships. Create long-lasting relationships so that you can find ways to help other people, and hopefully someday maybe those people can help you. So, how do you do it? Let's talk about it. First of all, the most important thing in networking, the most important thing in life, the most important thing that you can ever do is to get off the couch and go do it. Look, I don't need to tell that to you, this group. You came out here to hear this talk in the rain, and you're here. So many people have the greatest ideas in the world, so many people that they sit home by themselves on their computer and don't go out and talk to others. And don't try to learn from other people. You gotta get up. You gotta go out there. You can't do this. You just can't use the F word. And here's the F word that I'm talking about. It's this word that I think that maybe some of you may have heard, may have professors or other people talk about this. But so many people in the entrepreneurial world today say, to fail fast. It's okay to fail. Fail and then go do something else. I hate this word. We don't use this word in my household. We don't, this fail word, we don't use. I mean, how many of you ever try to fail a test while you're in school? Anyone ever try to fail a test? No, you wouldn't be here too. I mean, I mean, it doesn't make sense. So why would you go fail in business? Who tries to go fail in when you go out and play basketball, right? You try to miss shots? Do you really try to miss shots? I mean, it doesn't make any sense. You go out on the basketball court, you try to miss a shot on purpose. So why would you try to fail and fail fast? So all these business geniuses out there are using this terminology, and I can't stand it. So I don't believe in that. What I do believe in is actually how to go out and meet people, and how do you do this? So what do you say? The hardest thing, I think, in networking is when you go to one of these events. You know, do you all know each other here, for the most part? No? Yes? Somewhat. So you're in this room with some people you don't know. And if you were, we may do this later, if you're sort of forced to get to meet each other, well, what do you say? Like, what do you walk up to somebody and say to them, right? So I always think about this, right? So I think about this. And this is how, I think, I used to think this is how networking, I just get nervous to go around and meet people. Because I wasn't the most gregarious person. I wasn't all excited to go run around and say hi to everybody. I was a little nervous. Because I'm always thinking about this situation, but this is not networking. I mean, this guy, right? Let's think about this guy. What's going through his head when he's asking her out? Okay, I'll answer it. So he's saying, well, okay, hope that she'll go out with me. I want to take her out to dinner. Then I want to take her to the movies. And then maybe dancing or something. I won't dance because Sabrina, you know, Rachel knows my daughter Sabrina. She teases me when I dance. My 16-year-old, she thinks I'm not a very good dancer. But he wants to take her out to a dance. Then he wants to take her, he's all thinking about this. What are you saying? Will you go out with me? Then he wants to take her back to his apartment or his dorm. And he wants to put a little music on maybe. And then he tries to kiss and clothes come off and all that kind of stuff, right? That's what he's thinking when he's saying to her, will you go out with me? That's not what you need to think about in a networking situation. It's really, really simple. In a networking situation, all you need to do is you need to just think about getting someone else's business card. That's it. How much simpler is that if you just think about it in those situations? It's really simple. So all I need is like, hi, I'm Wayne. What's your name?
Eric,
right? We met earlier, sorry. Here's my card. Do you have a card? So Eric then gives me his card, and I get his card. It says, Eric, Duke University. Great, thank you very much. And I take his card. That's it. I don't need anything else. We now are connected. Why? Let's talk about it, right? So here's the thing. So what do I do every single day? So I wake up in the morning, I get dressed. Next thing I do is I take a pile of business cards and I put it in my right pocket, okay? And then my goal every single day is to give out all these cards and then get cards back and then fill up my left pocket. That's my goal. Simple. Just get as many contacts as possible, but then what do you do? Right? Then what you do? Then didn't you want to go and you just want to, what I say is I always fill up all my shoe boxes, right? Put all my cards in all these different shoe boxes. And a lot of these were, you know, mine growing up, but also now my 13-year-old son, he loves sneakers, so we're constantly, so now I use a lot of his boxes to fill up my business cards. But you put them in these boxes, and I call it my goal, because these contacts that I now have that are in my boxes allow me to stay in touch with people for the rest of our lives. Now, how do you do that? How do you stay in touch with those people? So normally, at this point of the presentation, I have a shoebox with me, and I don't have a shoebox with me today, but I have this bag, and I normally pull out my gold out of my shoebox. So hey, here we go. What's up, boy? What's up? Oh, watch out back there. Here you go. Here's a couple things, you guys. This is the gold that's normally in my shoebox, but today it's just a bag. So you guys, need some more. Where are we? Back to the back. Anyone else need some? Normally at this point, I didn't bring a shoebox with me, so so in that shoebox are all the cards. But I don't just keep them in a shoebox, because that's not going to do anything. What I do is, I then send an email out to each person I get a card from. And I said to them, it's really nice meeting you. It was nice meeting you. I look forward to staying in touch with you. Then I try to link in with them on whether it's on LinkedIn or connect with them on any of the social networks out there, so we can stay in touch. We can stay in touch because why? What do I do? What's my favorite day of the year?
People's birthday.
Why do I love people's birthdays so much?
It gives you an excuse to go on a wall and write happy birthday.
And it gives me an opportunity to wish them happy birthday, and he heard this talk about 2 years ago. And I've been wishing you happy birthday for now
2 years.
2 years. But it also lets me know what's going on in your life. And allows me to say, happy birthday. Oh, by the way, I just noticed your sister got married. Your brother got married. You got married. You just got a new job. You're the new CEO of Nike. You're the new CEO of Under Armour. You're the new CEO of Apple or whatever. Because probably one of you here, three of you, all of you, expect to be something really famous and really important someday. And it's an opportunity for all of us to stay in touch with each other. And figure out a way so that we just stay in touch. And to me, it's once you get this card, put this information here, it allows you to keep in touch with someone forever. Forever. So why don't we do this? Let's practice. Let's practice networking, okay? So if you don't know someone else in this room, if you could get up, introduce yourself to somebody else. Now, if you don't have a card,
I know you. Yeah.
You could just have them, you could just easily just tell them to follow you on whatever it is. Twitter, Instagram, whatever it is. Yeah. Just introduce yourself to somebody.
Thank you.
So people say in networking, they tell you to go network. I'm happy you guys are meeting new people. It's important. It's important, and I hope that one of these connections in the room tonight allows you guys, I don't know, to get married in the future, or to just help each other. Because again, we probably have major, someone in this room will be a major CEO of a company. There's no doubt. There's no doubt about it. We're doomed. We're like the top students in the world, okay? Someone here will be that incredible person, at least one. Make sure you stay in touch. So if you want to network and you want to meet the top people in the world, where do they go? Where do they hang out? You have any idea where these people go? So here's what I talk about all the time. My favorite networking movie is Wedding Crashers. It's the best movie ever. Because it's not about, their whole thing was to go meet chicks, right? That was their whole idea. But for me, I love this movie, and gosh, my wife thought I was crazy, because I'm sitting in the movie theater, I don't know, 13, 14 years ago when this came out, and they come out with a line when they tell somebody that they were venture capitalists, and I start cracking up, and no one else in the room even knew what a venture capitalist was. This is 13 or 14 years ago. The Shark Tank thing wasn't on TV yet. And so she's like, shh, stop laughing. What's wrong with you? And I'm like, no, seriously, this is awesome, because here's what these guys do. What can you learn from this movie? First of all, they make sure that they dress the part. So if you want to meet somebody, and if it's a wedding or it's an event where people are wearing ties and suits, and it's a business attire event, you wear business attire. If it's a black tie event, you go find a tux, borrow a tux, rent a tux, wear a tux, I don't know. I mean, and that's how you show up. Or if it's casual, you show up casual. So then you basically fit in. Because the bottom line is you're not going to get invited to these events as a kid, right? Or as an entrepreneur who wants to go make it all happen. Like, you don't just get let in. I mean, I don't know, you don't just get to hang out with billionaires all the time. They don't just, like, invite you into their club. Like, if you're starting a company, right, you want to start a company and you need to raise capital, you want to go where the money is. You need to go where the money is. But the problem is, a lot of entrepreneurs don't know where the money is. They don't know where to go. They don't know where the money people hang out. Right? They don't know where to find them. Well, where do they go every single, I said they, right? Where do they, seriously, where do they go every single morning? Every city in the world, no matter where you're from. Anyone have any idea where they go in the morning, every single morning? That's a good one. You can't answer it.
What? Starbucks?
The coffees don't cost enough. No. Here's where they go. They go to 4 to 5 star hotels and restaurants, right? They go to the top places. So whether it's the Four Seasons in Hong Kong, the Four Seasons in New York, or in Miami, or wherever, they hang out at the Four Seasons, the Ritz-Carlton, all the top places. That's where they have their business meetings. That's where the top people hang out. They're all the best places, the best steakhouses. How many of you are from New York? Anyone from New York? Been to the Regency Hotel? Anyone been there? Right? So who has breakfast there every morning? I promise you go to breakfast there every single morning, you'll find at least 5 CEOs in the eating breakfast every single morning at the Regency Hotel. Go in there and go meet them. So why am I telling you all this stuff? And why do I think they go there, right? Well, first of all, who the hell can afford an $18 omelet as a kid or as an entrepreneur, right? 18 bucks to go buy probably this one's like 25 bucks. You're a young entrepreneur. You're trying to save your money. You're trying to build your business, right? But you're not going in there and then for two, that's probably 50 bucks, right? That's crazy to spend that kind of money if you're doing a startup, you're starting your business. But the people that are eating in there, they can't afford that stuff. So what did I do? So as a young, my 20s, I wanted to break into this industry. So I keep saying this. I keep saying my wife thought I was crazy, and she always thinks I'm crazy. But I would wake up in the morning, around 6 something in the morning, I would go to one of these breakfast places. Many times in Philadelphia, where we live, and I would go there, and I would fill my right pocket up with business cards, and my left pocket would be empty. And my goal was to introduce myself to anyone and everyone who walked into that restaurant. That was my goal. And many times I introduced myself to people who were like on vacation, who were like, why are you saying hello to me? What are you trying to, what's wrong with you? You're like was going to go into that restaurant, not only be able to afford that omelet, but to actually sit down with a CEO or a very successful person and have omelets together. That was my goal. That was my goal. And over time, I would get people's business cards. I'd put them in my shoebox. I'd connect with them. Now, remember, this was in the 90s when I first started doing this stuff. Many of those people didn't even have email addresses on their cards. So I'd have to call them. I'd have to call them or write a letter, call their assistant to ask, hey, can Mr. So-and-so have breakfast with me at the Four Seasons or the Ritz-Carlton or the... There's a place in Philadelphia called the Conshohocken Marriott that has a lot of really, really important people go meet there because it's kind of convenient to a lot of people. But that was my goal, to be in the game. And my whole way to get there was through the business card. So I'm gonna do a quick quiz here. So you go to these networking events and they give you name tags, right? So most people just stick it on and they don't have any reason to put it on one side. I truly believe there's a right side to do it. There's a correct side to wear your name tag. So how many of you think that the guy has his name tag in the right place? Okay? Who thinks it's the woman? Okay. So you have the hand up. Why the woman? Why do you think it's the woman?
Must be a right-handed.
No, you're exactly right. So I believe if you're going to wear a name tag, wear it on the right side. So that when what's your name?
Michael.
Michael. When I shake Michael's hand, he's looking here, and I'm looking right there. Because if you're trying to tell people who you are, you don't want them to like look across. Because let's say Michael was a woman, and I looked across, I would get in trouble for looking across his chest. But don't. But seriously, like that's the whole thing is. You're going to throw me out already? No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. No, but I mean, is this? But the whole idea is that if you're in a network event, you wanna meet people. You're not there to have lunch. You're not here to eat the snacks and drink or whatever it is there. You're there to meet people and then get out of there and go do all that stuff with your friends afterwards. You're there just to meet people. So I wanted to touch on, since this is Tom Eid, and really briefly talk about two companies that I've been involved with in Israel. I know that's something that you guys do here. So I don't know if you have read the book Startup Nation, and if you haven't, I highly recommend you skim it or just put it on your phone and just read it once in a while. It's a great book. It really talks about all the innovation and things that are happening in Israel. There's even updates to some of the stories that were in there. It's an incredible story, and there's parts in there that talk about one of my heroes, Shimon Peres. Who really was one of the catalysts behind the whole startup nation of Israel. And now his son, who I'm very lucky to call a friend, his name's Chemi Peres, and he is really kind of taking a lot of the things that his dad started and moving those things forward. His dad, Chemi, is one of the top venture capitalists in Israel at a venture capital fund called Potango. And he's just forget the venture capital, he's just a wonderful person, just like his dad. And I was very lucky to meet his dad a number of times and actually get a chance to even introduce my own dad to him. So I get sort of choked up just even thinking about what he's done for not only Israel, but for the world and for innovation. I was very lucky also to have the opportunity to invest in a couple companies in Israel. So far, one of the first companies we invested in, we sold to IBM, and currently I'm an investor in a company called Quick. I don't know if any of you have seen the Amazon Dash buttons, the buttons you can kind of push and reorder products. Quick does something very similar to what Amazon does. It's just that instead of, it's all sort of a white label. So we work directly with the brands themselves, so like Tide, we do the Tide button for Procter & Gamble, not you don't have to buy your products through Amazon. So this is a really interesting company that's out of Israel right now, also based in Silicon Valley, and we were very early investors in this company. Hopefully I can write underneath here that, I don't know, let's think of who would buy them. I don't know, Walgreens or something, or Amazon, or who knows, or Walmart, or someone that would go underneath here. someday, and then that'll be fun. I want to show you something else. I'm also an investor in Whistle Sports. I don't know how many of you have seen Dude Perfect and some of the trick shot videos that these guys have done. This was another one of these really awesome companies that we got involved with very early, where it was really just an idea. It was just an idea to allow people to create really fun content and share that with millennials. And it's gone from just a really fun company to one of the biggest companies in the whole, you know, sports media world. We were the first investors in the company with Mia Hamm, Derek Jeter, and Peyton Manning. And now NBC Sports and Sky Media and Liberty Media and all these Tegna, all these really big companies have put, you know, tens of millions of dollars into the company, and it's really growing. Here's a little fun video from there. From
no, I say it's true. I can feel the love. Can you feel it too? I can feel it.
Idea just explodes and becomes, you know, what these guys have done today. I mean, this is actually like 12 billion views across all the videos that we've done now. I mean, it's just blowing up. I mean, it's incredible. It's incredible to work with really smart, nice entrepreneurs who are doing big stuff. So that's leave it with that. So let me just jump to sort of the last section of my talk. Which I think is actually probably the most important part, because it really brings together the whole idea of being an entrepreneur, of being able to go out and network, but also when you're networking, you start thinking about what can you do for other people, right? I mean, the question really comes down to is like, how can I help you? How can I help others? You know, so many people go and they want to find that billionaire, billion-dollar investor or something like that, and their hands out. Everyone's got their hand out. Give me something. Give me some money. Give me some contacts. Buy my company. Do something for me. But how can you help others? Right? So you're sometimes sitting with someone who's way more powerful than you, way more important than you, but I bet that you can figure out a way to do something to help them. And that'll change the whole game, because most people don't think about other people. Most people don't think about helping others. And I believe that if you do that, you will totally flip the tables. So regardless of who you are, how much you have, how much you don't have, this and that, you can help someone else. You know, even if you're having the worst day of your life, there's probably someone else out there who's having an even worse day that you can actually help them. It's an interesting way to think about it. You know, unfortunately, I've had the opportunity to work with great organizations, including Tamid. As I was sharing with Michael and some of you earlier, I was lucky enough to meet the original founders of Tamid from the University of Michigan a couple, about 5 or 6 years ago, and introduced them to a group of students from the University of Maryland, which then started the second campus, the second Tamid group, and now it's amazing how it's just gone all over the country, and I'm just so proud of how things have gone. And so I've had the opportunity of being involved in lots of different organizations, and I highly recommend you doing these types of things as well. So I'm going to wrap up before we do some questions with what I like to call is sort of my top secret tip. And I truly believe that if you do these two like simple little things, that you will stand out and be more, I truly believe, be more successful than anyone else by simply just doing this. Simply saying please and thank you. It's so crazy. I'm sure that your parents or your people or teachers or people when you're growing up have told you to say please and thank you. But it's amazing in the business world how many people don't. How many people just take it for granted and take things from other people and don't say thank you. The simple thing of getting someone else's business card and then quickly writing them back an email saying, hey, thanks for your card. It was great meeting you. Look forward to staying in touch. Simple like that. So many people don't do that. And if you do that, you will be part of that 1% in this world that doesn't do it, that does it. And you'll stand out. Now, here's another interesting tip on this, right? So let's say you're here at Duke University, this great, great college where you probably have an opportunity to meet people who many other people probably don't get a chance to meet, right? And they probably come into your classes and give talks, or you see them walking around, because who wouldn't want to walk around and check this place out? And you meet them. And you have this opportunity to shoot them an email, right? To get their information. You get their card. You find out their information. So let's say this major CEO comes here, and you get a chance to meet them. And then you get their contact information. Now, you probably want to, you're good, so you're gonna send out that thank you note. But you don't want to send that thank you note or that thank you email at like 11 in the afternoon, in the morning, or like at 2 p.m. because that really important CEO is really busy and it could get lost in that person's email. So send that email, that thank you email, at like 2 a.m., 5 a.m., or on a Saturday, or on a Sunday, when it could be the first thing that person sees when she wakes up in the morning and it's right on her phone. And she's like, wow, that's so cool. I met that guy at Duke, and now he's sending me this email on a Sunday morning, right? That's how you stand out. How you stand out, you try to stay in front. You want to think about how you can stand out and be more, you know, allow you to stand out and be successful in life. So I'm going to stop here. I'm going to just tell you, again, Michael, thank you so much for having me here. It means so much to be at another Tamid campus, to be here at Duke University. It's such a great place. And I just think that I wish all of you a ton of luck, and I hope that you'll go out there and do everything you can to just be successful in life. So thank you.
We have about 2 minutes for questions.
Yes.
So like when you were at these breakfast places, out of curiosity, what exactly did you start out with? Like, what exactly did you say? You said a pie and I was like,
yeah, so I mean exactly, okay? Exactly. So the name of my company that I started was, it wasn't very creative. It was called KimmelCorp.com. It was like the mid-90s. Like everything was .com. So I made up this thing. Last name, I put Corp on the end, .com. I couldn't get Kimmel.com, I guess it was. So I was KimmelCorp.com. So I'd say, hi, my name's Wayne. Here's my card, right? Here's my card. It says, I already gave you a card. Didn't you give it to what's your name?
I'm Anya.
Anya. So, hi, I'm Wayne. And I'm Wayne Kimmel. Here's my card. And on my card it said, founder or chairman and CEO of KimmelCorp.com. I'm laughing now, right? And it said, I would fund and incubate startup internet companies. That's what it said. And I would hand my card. So I would say, hi, I'm Wayne. Here's my card. Can I have your card? That's all I would say. That's it. Like, that's simple. And I would just get it, and I would put it, and sometimes I would like be like, I get it, I'm like, run away, because I'm so scared. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. I was so nervous. But at the other time, if you get the card, then if I got the card and my hands weren't shaking too much, I would say, oh, my gosh, that's you're the CEO of, you know, Goldman Sachs or something. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's really cool. Or what do you do? Or what's your job? Like, I could maybe ask a question off of that card. But normally I would get the card and get out, and then I would give myself time to go write the email or try to gather myself.
Lastly, 15 seconds, if you would.
Fast, yeah. Yes?
Do you ever worry about sort of being intrusive in that type of situation?
Like yes.
Like eating, you know, the breakfast, or maybe having breakfast with someone else, and you just, you know, I would think they'd say, no, who are you?
Right, so do you ever think about being intrusive? And interrupting people. You know what? I don't think about it that much. Because in many cases, if you have that opportunity, right, you just gotta take it. You just gotta go for it. And sometimes you may be interrupting people and you could just say, I'm really sorry, I just wanted to give you my card. Here's my card, and hopefully we get a chance to work together at some point. And then just kinda go away. Or say, do you have a card? And I can just And then they may like think you're crazy, but if you need to meet that person, you just gotta go for it. So I'll tell you a quick story, and this is the story we, Dustin and I were talking about earlier, and it's one of my favorite networking stories ever. I needed to meet Steve Ballmer, right? Anyone know Steve? Everyone knows Steve Ballmer, right? Steve, what?
Microsoft.
He was the CEO of Microsoft, and now
he is the owner
of the Los Angeles Clippers. And he bought the Clippers for like $2.1 billion. And by the way, where's the Panera? Panera, how about, do you guys know Panera was just bought today? Did you read that?
$7.5 billion
Panera was bought for today.
By
some British company. Yeah, crazy. Unbelievable, so that's some good Panera right there. Anyway, the point is, so I needed to meet Steve Ballmer. So I had to figure out how I could actually, I guess, ambush him in a way, or find him. I needed to meet him for one of my companies. So what I did was I found out that he was speaking at an event in New York City. And so I saw he was going to be the keynote speaker, and he was supposed to go on stage around 8 or 8:30 at this conference on the west side at the Sheraton. Have you ever been to that Sheraton on the west side? And so I get up at like 4 in the morning, I drive from Philadelphia, I go to New York City, and I'm standing, it was a rainy day like this, I remember this, I had a raincoat and an umbrella, and I put it and I threw it off to the side, and I was standing in the middle of the lobby. What was in my right pocket? My business cards. I had my business cards in my right pocket, my left pocket was empty, and I was ready. I was like, just ready to meet this guy. And I knew I needed to meet him so that I could introduce one of my companies to one of his guys. So I'm standing there, and in walked, 7:15 in the morning, in walked Steve Ballmer, at the time CEO of Microsoft. He had his red tie, he always wore the signature red tie, it was hanging around his neck, it hadn't been tied yet, he had two bags, and I just walked up and said, "Hi, I'm Wayne." And he was like, "What the," you know, talking about interrupting somebody, right? I mean, I interrupted, said he hadn't even had his coffee yet, and he was probably like, "Oh my God, who are you?" Right, drops one of his bags, shakes my hand, and he was, and I'm like, I said, "And Hal Rosenbluth says hello." And he's like, "You're friends with Hal?" I said, "Yeah." He's like, oh my God. I hope Hal didn't tell you the story. You'll see Hal, he's on the back of my book. He's the guy who did that, the company that we sold to Walgreens. And he says, "Oh my God, you know Hal?" He's like, yeah. He didn't tell you that story, did he? And then Steve Ballmer starts to smile. And he's like, You mean the one? He goes, "Yeah, the one where I crashed his computer by trying to put Outlook on his computer. Did he tell you that story?" I'm like, "Yeah, I know that." And we both start laughing. And all of a sudden, like, this major CEO guy, right, and I are just like, I wouldn't say we were boys, right? We were kind of like, at least chill, right? It wasn't like I was now this crazy stalker, which I kind of was, but wasn't, right? But at this point, he said, "So what's up? Are you here to hear my speech?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm here to hear your speech, but I also," he's like, "Well, is there anything I can do to help you?" And he's like, "Yeah, you know what, I really need to talk to one of your lieutenants." He's like, "Well, give me one of your cards and my assistant will get back to you." So I give him one of my cards, he tells me, I don't even get one of his cards, he's like, "Look, I gotta go give my speech, I'll see you inside." I didn't even go inside, I got back in my car, I drove back to my office back in Philadelphia. By 11 a.m. that morning, I got an email from his assistant connecting me with the person that I need to get connected with. So, like, there are times when you're going to have to ambush people a little bit, kind of bump into them by mistake, okay, like, quote-unquote mistake. If you need to make it happen, you just got to figure out a way to go do it, because it's just not going to happen. It won't just happen if you just hang out and you just sit on your couch. Yes?
I have a couple really quick questions. The first one is, I'm going to be in Israel for 6 weeks. What's one business-oriented thing you would recommend I do? Who are your biggest role models in entrepreneurship? And what's your favorite scene of Wedding Crashers?
All right, I'll take them in reverse order. My favorite scene is when they said they were venture capitalists. I mean, there's nothing better than that. Who are some people that I really look up to? You know what, it's pretty easy for me. I mean, I'm very fortunate. I really look up to my dad, you know, like more than any, I mean, he's the one who, more than anybody, really, and I talk about it in my book, and he's the one who really taught me about being a good person, saying nice things about people, doing things for other people, and it all sort of come back. So come back in spades. I mean, it really, really does. I mean, there are definitely times when you're like, all I'm doing is trying to help other people, and my God, someday it's going to come back. But you know what? It does come back. And I truly believe that. And the first question was, where should you go in Israel? I have a few people that I would recommend you meeting, and they know everything that's going on in Israel. But I would recommend like going and check it out. Like the different, there's so many cool like co-working spaces in Israel. There's even the one that I talked about Femi earlier. I mean, he has one called Sosa, which is a really cool place. There's both in Tel Aviv as well as in Jerusalem. And there's really a lot of interesting stuff. There's so much happening there. It's such a cool scene. I mean, other than Silicon Valley, it's happening in Israel. I mean, those are the two hottest places for innovation. Yes.
Yeah, and I have a twofold question. What's the hardest thing you've ever had to do, and how did you do it?
So probably the hardest thing I ever had to do was I was 29 years old, and I decided I was going to be a venture capitalist. And I didn't, you know, one of the dirty little secrets that I didn't know about, I guess it was good that I didn't know, but most venture capitalists either go to work for other venture capitalists, or they're like really rich, or their parents are really rich, and their parents like gave them a lot of money. So this is being taped, so what's the difference? Anyway, the point is that's what happens. I mean, that's one of the craziest things. If you really look at who the venture capitalists are around the world, they're like really rich people. And they started that way, and they took their money or their family's money and started it, and then they've built them in, believe me, they took it and built it to really big things. But one of the hardest things was not starting with that. And I was just the guy running around knocking on doors, hi, I'd like to meet you. Would you invest in my fund? So the hardest thing was I went out, and I talk about this in my book, and I went and sat with a guy who was one of the godfathers in the venture capital industry, and he says to me, if you raise $9 million, I'll give you one. Well, it was the greatest day of my life. I like floated out of his office thinking that I had just like won the lottery, but then I was like, wait a second. I called my dad, and he's like, you gotta go raise $9 million. How the heck are you gonna do that? Have you ever done that before? I'm like, no. I'm like, I'll figure it out. And I did. Not only did I raise nine, I raised $19 million. And then I went back to the guy and said, hey, I raised $19 million. You ready to write your check for $1 million? And he was like, seriously? Did you really just do that? And that was the greatest thing. So it's hard, yes. Another one. Oh my God, two questions. Just 1 second. Yeah. Sorry.
All right, so let's say someone's giving you a pitch deck for a software company.
Yeah.
What are some of the key metrics you're looking for?
Okay, so if someone was giving me a pitch deck for a software company, one of the key metrics is not the metrics. What I actually want to know is, who the heck are these guys, right? Who are the people behind it, right? That's, to me, that's more important than metrics. It's more important what the heck the business is, what about the market. To me, it's about who are these people. How invested are they in this business? Whether that's cash, whether that's time, whether that's, you know, and who are they? You know, are they the kind of people that I not only want to work with, that I actually can work with and can help? So if it's a software company in a business-to-business thing for manufacturing of, I don't know, whatevers, I don't know anything about manufacturing. That's not my thing. If it's a software business that's focused on the consumer, focused on the sports industry or the wellness or health industry, oh yeah, I'm your guy. Right now I understand. So a lot of times I'll get business plans from software engineers or other people that I just don't understand, and that's not what I do. And then I just say, you know, I don't understand that. Let me pass it off to somebody else. But if it's something that, and then I, and again, if I truly can connect with the person, then we'll start talking about metrics and this and that. And many times in the kind of companies that I get involved with, the startups, there are no metrics. There's nothing yet. It's just an idea. And they hope that someday there will be metrics. Yes?
How have you dealt with, or how often has it occurred that you've just been flat out rejected? And how do you deal with that when it happens?
Well, look, getting rejected and getting sort of it sucks, right? I mean, it's like you get all excited, and sometimes you get on a plane and you fly somewhere. And in many cases, that for me, that would be like in a situation where I'm fundraising for one of my funds or something, and it's really hard. I mean, and that's why I say I'm at first, you know, I'm first an entrepreneur,
and second a venture capitalist, because it's the same kind of thing. It's hard. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, there are incredibly dark moments being an entrepreneur and going out there and trying to pitch yourself. And I mean, it's like, you know, it's really tough. But the thing is, you got to get up. After you get knocked down, you got to get up. It's like anything. I mean, you play sports. One of the reasons I love investing with and working with athletes, because you've been there. Like you're in the game and you get knocked down, you hurt yourself, but you got to get up. And you got to get up, and then you got to keep moving. So you can't let one person who like hits you with a haymaker and you're like, it hurts so bad, and you're lying there bloody on the ground, but you got to get up. And I see that with I mean, my God, I think back to the original days of the founders of Seamless Web, which is now public as Grubhub, and it's a few billion-dollar business, and it's, you know, one of the top, you know, online ordering companies in the world. But those guys, when they started that business, and they were walking into people's offices saying, you know what, we're gonna, this is how you're gonna order food from now on, and they're just getting doors slammed in their face. Just gotta find another door to open. You just gotta keep moving. And it's hard. And there's times when it's just like, oh my God, I don't think it's ever gonna work again. But you know what? You wake up the next morning and you go again. And you just gotta keep pushing along. And don't, it's, yeah, I talk about it, and I have a chapter in my book about, you know, every no, I think it's every no is a not yet, right? You just gotta keep moving. And sometimes, you know, sometimes there's people that say no to you. Some people say absolutely not. But if you develop a relationship with them and stay with them, and maybe you'll get to yes. Maybe you'll get to yes.
A lot of the time, startups aren't only looking for financial investments, they're looking for intellectual investments. How do you see people go about finding mentors in their space?
So how do you find mentors, you know, to help you out? I mean, I think first of all, most people know what they sort of are looking for, right? And I always say, you know, go for that untouchable person, right? The one that you, they're way too busy, it's not their thing. They're gonna say not yet because you're just a startup. But like, you have an idea, you're like gonna do something in, let's pick a person. I don't know. I won't even use an example. But there's someone that you've gotta network your way to that person, whoever it is, whoever you believe that could help you take your business to a whole other level. There's no like magic to finding a mentor. There's no magic to finding, you know, it's about just going after them and asking them. That's what it's all about. Yes.
With how competitive venture capital has gotten over the recent years, would you recommend for someone to go into that space at this time?
So is it venture capital is competitive? Yeah, it's always been competitive. Every business is competitive. Being the best is really hard at whatever you do. If this is what you want to do, you can go for it. I mean, I think, you know, the venture capital business is a male-dominated business. It shouldn't be. It just is. It's a white male-dominated business, okay? So, and it also shouldn't just be. So, I think there's opportunities. I think there's some interesting opportunities out there, because entrepreneurs aren't just white males.